From all, it's bringing counterterrorism expert and advisor Gadi Adelman and Safra Marofsky, the executive director of Scholars for Peace in the Middle East. Thank you both for joining us tonight. Gadi, if we take a look at previous peace initiatives, the Palestinian rejection has always come with an increase in violence. Arafat, for example, launched the Second Intifada after rejecting the Camp David offer, which gave the Palestinians more than 90% of what they were asking for. Gadi, is this potentially the beginning of a third Intifada?
Certainly wouldn't be a surprise if it went that route. This is what Abbas has been calling for without coming out and saying, you know, let's have an uprising or an intifada. He has made other statements to definitely bring his people out and ask for violent demonstrations. So, you know, this is not a surprise at all, and it wouldn't surprise me if it went that route.
Gadi, how can Israel prepare and respond to this now?
You know, unfortunately, it's going to be the same situation as both the first and second Intifada, and it's going to have to be, Israelis are going to have to be much more aware. And we see this each and every time this happens, where as they become more lackadaisical, for lack of a better term, and less unaware of their surroundings, as this occurs, then they start to become more cognizant of what's going on around them, and they start to become more aware. It's going to have to be a much more larger presence, if you will, of both the border police and the Israeli Defense Forces in all of these flashpoints.
Asaf, what impact is this having on the political landscape? Do you see the surge in violence, and perhaps if it increases even further, impacting the elections, which are now less than a month away, Asaf?
Well, I mean, I think it both ways. For sure, they're trying to put pressure on the political parties. Abbas is trying to show his disgruntlement with the administration. Next week, he's going to be coming to New York to make a press conference with Ehud Olmert to try to show that, you know, there are Israelis he can talk to, but he really dislikes Netanyahu and Netanyahu's government. So for sure, it's impacting the area. But again, from a military standpoint, Benny Gantz and Benjamin Netanyahu don't disagree. And to Gadi's point, I mean, they're going to have to be much more vigilant as far as showing police presence domestically and on the borders as they're trying to heat up the area, which they're going to try to heat up all borders, north and south, in a way to show their disgruntlement with Netanyahu and the Trump administration at large.
But Abbas, do you see Netanyahu potentially taking more decisive action now, maybe launching something more decisive as the elections are coming up March 2nd?
I'm sure you'll see a lot more, you know, attempt to do so. I think that there's going to be checks and balances, you know, in that regard. But I think that when it comes to real security issues, as we're seeing now, and when Israeli citizens are indeed in the line of fire, there's going to be an agreement, and that's where they're going to find the status quo between the blue and white party and the Netanyahu party. I don't think it's really going to change the Israeli electorate. People pretty much now in the third round of elections are pretty much decided where they want to go one way or another, and the elections will pretty much, you know, kind of maintain the status quo. But when it comes to, again, maintaining Israeli security and citizenship, there is no disagreement right there.
Gadi, in terms of Israeli security, there's been an agreement between the Palestinian Authority and Israel, between Fatah and Israel, to have some kind of cooperation, to give them some kind of a heads up, some kind of deal with regards to security. Abbas has been threatening to stop that. Help us understand the dynamic and what it would mean if Abbas does indeed completely cut those security ties with Israel.
Well, you know, he's already stated, and I will answer your question, but he's already stated that he doesn't want his security forces working with Israel. He came out and said that on January 28th when the deal of the century, the peace plan, was unveiled at the White House. As far as how it works right now, and we've covered this on your show before, you have three different sectors right now of the so-called West Bank, the Judea and Samaria area, sector A, B, and C. One of those sectors is governed both by Israel in cooperation with the Palestinian Authority security. One is strictly by Israel, and one is strictly by the Palestinians. So they do work together. However, as I said at the outset, he's already told his security forces, don't work with Israel anymore, when instructing his own activists to call for a day of rage.
Yeah. Asaf, back to what we can expect here in New York next week. Former Prime Minister Olmert reportedly joining Abbas for a joint press conference. He served some jail time for corruption in Israel. He's not exactly in the highest of standings politically. What do you make of this move by Olmert, Asaf?
Kind of ironic altogether to begin with. I mean, interestingly enough, during the Olmert administration, he actually offered Abbas a lot more than, you know, was offered to him now on the table, and he rejected it again now. I think, again, he's trying to create, mostly Abbas and the PA, kind of create these fragmentations within Israeli society and showing, you know, here are Israelis I'm willing to work with, even a guy like Ehud Olmert. For Olmert, I think, you know, he's trying to, you know, clean his record. I mean, he sat in jail, wrote a book about 900 pages, trying to redeem himself, and now he's trying to position himself once again as a former Israeli prime minister, saying, I can broker peace, I can do things, even though if you look at the historical record as far as Israeli prime ministers, he's not ranked highly, to say the least.
No, he's not. All right, thank you so much, Asaf Omarovsky. Gadi Edelman, appreciate it as always.